चैप्टर 6 जनरल प्रिंसिपल्स एंड प्रोसेस ऑफ आइसोलेशन ऑफ एलिमेंट्स। थर्मोडायनेमिक्स इलस्ट्रेट्स व्हाई ओनली अ सर्टेन रिड्यूसिंग एलिमेंट एंड अ मिनिमम स्पेसिफिक टेम्परेचर आर सूटेबल फॉर रिडक्शन ऑफ अ मेटल ऑक्साइड टू अ मेटल इन एन एक्सट्रैक्शन। द हिस्ट्री ऑफ सिविलाइजेशन इज लिंक्ड टू यूज ऑफ मेटल्स इन एंटिक्विटी इन मेनी वेज। डिफरेंट पीरियड्स ऑफ अर्ली ह्यूमन सिविलाइजेशंस हैव been named after metals. The skill of extraction of metals gave many metals and brought about several changes in the human society and gave weapons, tools, ornaments, utensils, etc. and enriched the cultural life. The seven metals of antiquity, as they are sometimes called, are gold, copper, silver, lead, tin, iron and mercury. Although modern metallurgy had exponential growth after industrial revolution, it is interesting to note that many modern concepts in metallurgy have their roots in ancient practices that predated the industrial revolution. For over 1000 years, India has had a rich tradition of metallurgical skills. The two important sources of the history of Indian metallurgy are archaeological excavations and literary evidences. The first evidence of metal in Indian subcontinent comes from Mirgarh in Balochistan, when a small copper bead dated to about 6000 BCE was found. It is, however, thought to be native copper, which has not been extracted from the ore. Spectrometric studies on copper are samples obtained from the ancient mine pits at Khetri in Rajasthan and on metal samples cut from representative Harappan artifacts from Mithalal in Haryana and 8 other sites distributed in Rajasthan, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra prove that copper metallurgy in India dates back to the Chalcolithic cultures in the subcontinent. Indian Chalcolithic copper objects were in all probability made indigenously. The ore for extraction of metal for making the objects were obtained from chalcopyrite ore deposits in the Aravalli Hills. Collection of archaeological texts from copper plates and rock inscriptions have been compiled and published by the Archaeological Survey of India during the past century. Royal records were engraved on copper plates. Tamrapatra, earliest known copper plate, has a Mauryan record that mentions famine relief efforts. It has one of the very few pre-Ashoka Brahmani inscriptions in India. Harappans also used gold and silver, as well as their joint alloy electrum. Variety of ornaments such as pendants, bangles, beads and rings have been found in ceramic or bronze pots. Early gold and silver ornaments have been found from Indus Valley sites such as Mohenjo-daro 3000 BCE. These are on display in the National Museum, New Delhi, India. India has the distinction of having the deepest ancient gold mines in the world. In the Maski region of Karnataka, carbon dating places them in mid-first millennium BCE. Hymns of Rigveda give earliest indirect references to the alluvial placer gold deposits in India. The river Sindhu was an important source of gold in ancient times. It is interesting that the availability of alluvial placer gold in the river Sindhu has been reported in modern times also. It has been reported that there are great mines of gold in the region of Mansarovar and in Tok Jalyug even now. The Pali text Anguttara Nikaya narrates the process of recovery of gold dust or particles from alluvial placer gold deposits. Although evidence of gold refining is available in Vedic texts, it is Kautilya's Arthashastra, authored probably in 3rd or 4th century BCE during Mauryan era, which has much data on prevailing chemical practices in a long section on mines and minerals, including metal ores of gold, silver, copper, lead, tin and iron. Kautilya describes a variety of gold called Rasvidh, which is naturally occurring gold solution. Kalidas also mentioned about such solutions It is astonishing how people recognized such solutions. The native gold has different colors depending upon the nature and amount of impurity present in it. It is likely that the different colors of native gold were a major driving force for the development of gold refining. Recent excavations in central parts of Ganges Valley and Vindhya Hills have shown that iron was produced there possibly as early as in 1800 BCE. In the recent excavations conducted by the Uttar Pradesh State Archaeological Department, iron furnaces, artifacts, tires and layers of slag have been found. Radiocarbon dating places them between BCE 1800 and 1000. The results of excavation indicate that the knowledge of iron smelting and manufacturing of iron artifacts was well known in eastern Vindhyas and it was in use in the central Ganga plains. At least from the early 2nd millennium BCE, the quantity and types of iron artifacts and the level of technical advancements indicate that working of iron would have been introduced much earlier. The evidence indicates early use of iron in other areas of country, which proves that India was indeed an independent center for development of the working of iron. Iron smelting and use of iron was especially established in South Indian megalithic cultures. The forging of wrought iron seems to have peak in India in the 1st millennium CE. Greek accounts report that manufacture of steel in India by crucible process. In this process, iron, charcoal and glass were mixed together in a crucible and heated until the iron melted and absorbed the carbon. India was a major innovator in the production of advanced quality steel. Indian steel was called the wonder material of the Orient. A Roman historian, Quintus Curtius, records that one of the gifts Porus of Taxila gave to Alexander the Great was some 2.5 tons of wood steel. Wood steel is primarily iron containing a high proportion of carbon, 1 to 1.9%. Woods is the English version of the word ukku, which is used for steel in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. Literary accounts suggest that Indian woods, steel from southern part of the Indian subcontinent, were exported to Europe, China and Arab world. It became prominent in the Middle East, where it was named as Damascus steel. Michael Faraday tried to duplicate this steel by alloying iron with a variety of metals, including noble metals, but failed. When iron is reduced in solid state by using charcoal, porous iron blocks are formed. Therefore, reduced iron blocks are also called sponge iron blocks. Any useful product can be obtained from this material only after removing the porosity by hot forging. The iron so obtained is termed as wrought iron. An exciting example of wrought iron produced in ancient time is the world famous iron pillar. It was erected in its present position in Delhi in 5th century ECE. The Sanskrit inscription engraved on it suggests that it was brought here from elsewhere during the Gupta period. The average composition, weight percentage of the components present in the wrought iron of the pillar besides iron are 0.15% carbon, 0.05% silicon, 0.05% Mn, 0.25% phosphorus, 0.005% nickel, 0.03% copper and 0.02% nitrogen. The most significant aspect of the pillar is that there is no sign of corrosion in spite of the fact it has been exposed to the atmosphere for about 1600 years. Radiocarbon dating of charcoal from iron slag revealed evidence of continuous melting in Khasi Hills of Meghalaya. The slag layer, which is dated to 353 BCE CE 128, indicates that Khasi Hill region is the earliest iron smelting site studied in the entire region of northeast India. The remnants of former iron ore excavation and iron manufacturing are visible even now in the landscape of Khasi Hills. British naturalist who visited Meghalaya in early 19th century described the iron industry had developed in the upper part of the Khasi Hills. There is archaeological evidence of zinc production in Rajasthan mines at Zawar. From the 6th or 5th BCE, India was the first country to master zinc distillation. Due to low boiling point, zinc tends to vaporize while its ore is smelted. Pure zinc could be produced after a sophisticated downward distillation technique in which the vapor was condensed in a lower container. This technique was also applied to mercury. Indian metallurgists were master in this technique. This has been described in Sanskrit text of 14th century. Indians had knowledge about mercury. They used it for medicinal purpose. Development of mining and metallurgy declined during the British colonial era. By the 19th century, once flourished mines of Rajasthan were mostly abandoned and became almost extinct. In 1947, when India got independence, European literature on science had already found its way slowly into the country. Thus, in the post-independence era, the government of India initiated the process of nation building through the establishment of various institutes of science and technology. In the following sections, we will learn about some modern methods of extraction of metals. Occurrence of metals. A few metals like carbon, sulfur, gold, and noble gases occur in free state, while others are found in combined form in the Earth's crust. Elements vary in abundance. Among metals, aluminium is the most abundant. In fact, it is the third most abundant element in the Earth's crust. It is a major component of many ingenious materials, minerals including mica and clays. Many gemstones are impure forms of Al2O3. For example, gems ruby and sapphire have chromium and cobalt respectively as impurity. Iron is the second most abundant metal in the Earth's crust. It forms a variety of compounds and their various uses make it an important element. It is one of the essential elements in the biological systems as well. For obtaining a particular metal, first we look for minerals, which are naturally occurring chemical substances in the Earth's crust and are obtained through mining. Out of many minerals which a metal may be found, only few are viable to used as a source of that metal. Such minerals are known as ores. A particular element may occur in a variety of compounds. The process of isolation of element from its compound should be such that it is chemically feasible and commercially viable. For the purpose of extraction, bauxite is chosen for aluminium. For iron, usually oxide of ores which are abundant and do not produce polluting gas like SO2 are taken. For copper and zinc, any of the ores listed in the table may be used depending upon the availability and other relevant factors. The entire scientific and technological processes used for isolation of the metal from its ore is known as metallurgy. The extraction and isolation of an element from its combined form involves various principles of chemistry. Still, some general principles are common to all extraction process. Our ore really contains only a desired substance. It is usually contaminated with earthly or undesired materials known as gang. The extraction and isolation of metals from ores involves the following major steps: concentration of the ore, isolation of the metal from its concentrated ore, purification of the metal. In the following section, we shall describe the various steps for effective concentration of ores. After that, principles of some of the common metallurgical processes will be discussed. Those principles will include the thermodynamic and electrochemical aspects involved in the effective reduction of the concentrated ore to the metal. Concentration of ores. Removal of unwanted materials from the ore is known as concentration, dressing, or beneficiation. Before proceeding for concentration, ores are graded and crushed to reasonable size. Concentration of ores involves several steps, and selection of these steps depends upon the differences in physical properties of the compound of the metal present and that of the gang. The type of metal, the available facilities, and the environmental factors are also taken into consideration. Some of the important procedures for concentration of ore are described below. Hydraulic washing. This is based on the difference that specific gravities of the ore and the gang particles. It is therefore type of gravity separation. In one such process, the upward stream of running water is used to wash the powdered ore. The lighter gang particles are washed and heavier ore particles are left behind. Magnetic separation.
This process is based on the differences in magnetic properties of the ore components. If either of the ore or the gang is attracted towards magnetic field, then the separation is carried out by this method. For example, iron ores are attached towards magnet, hence non-magnetic impurities can be separated from them using magnetic separation. The powdered ore is dropped over a conveyor belt, which is moves over a magnetic roller. Magnetic substance remains attracted towards the belt and falls close to it. Froth flotation method. The method of removing gang from sulfide ores. In this process, a suspension of the powdered ore is made with water. Collectors and froth stabilizers are added to it. Collectors enhance non-wettability of the material particles, and froth stabilizers stabilize the froth. The mineral particles become wet by oils, while the gang particles by water. A rotating paddle agitates the mixture and draws air in it. As a result, froth is formed, which carries the mineral particles. The froth is light and skimmed off. It is then dried for recovery of the ore particles. Sometimes it is possible to separate two sulfide ores by adjusting proportion of oil to water or by using depressants. For example, in case of an ore containing ZnS and PbS, the depressant used is NaCN. It selectively prevents ZnS from coming to the froth but allows PbS to come with the froth. Leaching. Leaching is often used if the ore is soluble in some suitable solvent. Leaching of alumina from bauxite. Bauxite is the principal ore of aluminium. It usually contains SiO2, iron oxides and titanium oxides as impurities. Concentration is carried out by heating the powdered ore with concentration solution of NaOH at 473 to 523 Kelvin and 35 to 36 bar pressure. This process is called digestion. This way, aluminium oxide is extracted as sodium aluminate. This impurity SiO2 dissolves, forming sodium silicate. Other impurities are left behind. Al2O3 solid plus 2NaOH liquid aqueous plus 3H2O liquid gives 2NaAlOH4 aqueous. The sodium aluminate present in solution is neutralized by passing carbon dioxide gas, and hydrated Al2O3 is precipitated. At this stage, small amount of freshly prepared sample of hydrated Al2O3 is added to the solution. This is called seeding. It induces the precipitation. Sodium silicate remains in the solution and hydrated alumina is filtered, dried and heated to give back pure aluminium oxide. Other examples: in the metallurgy of silver and gold, the respective metal is leached with a dilute solution of NaCN or KCN in the presence of air, which supplies O2. The metal is obtained later by replacement reaction. Extraction of crude metal from concentrated ore. To extract metal from concentrated ore, it must be converted to a form which is suitable for reduction to metal. Usually sulfide ores are converted to oxide before reduction because oxides are easier to reduce. Thus, isolation of metals from concentrated ore involves two major steps: conversion to oxide and reduction to oxide to metal. Conversion to oxide. Calcination. Cancellation involves heating. It removes the volatile matter which escapes, leaving behind the metal oxide. ZnTO3 on heating gives ZnO plus CO2. Roasting. In roasting, the ore is heated in a regular supply of air in a furnace at a temperature below the melting point of metal. Some of the reactions involving sulfide ores are 2ZnS plus 3O2 gives 2ZnO plus 2SOO2. The sulfide ores of copper are heated in reverberatory furnace. If the ores contain iron, it is mixed off with silica before heating. Iron oxide slacks off as iron silicate and copper is produced in the form of copper matte, which contains Cu2S and FeS. FeO plus SiO2 gives FiSiO3. The SO2 produced is utilized for manufacturing H2SO4. Reduction of oxide to the metal. Reduction of the metal oxide usually involves heating it with the reducing agent. Reducing agent carbon combines with oxygen of the metal oxide. Some metal oxides get reduced easily while others are very difficult to be reduced, means electron gain by the metal ion. In any case, heating is required. Thermodynamic principles of metallurgy. Some basic concepts of thermodynamics helps us in understanding the theory of metallurgical transformations. Gibbs energy is the most significant term to understand the variation in temperature required for thermal reductions and to predict which element will suit as the reducing agent for a given metal oxide. Gibbs energy interpretations are made. The criteria for feasibility of a thermal reduction is that at a given temperature, Gibbs energy change of the reaction must be negative. The change in Gibbs energy delta G for any process at any specified temperature is described by the equation delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S, where delta H is the enthalpy change and delta S is the entropy change for the process. When the delta G is negative, only then the reaction will proceed. Delta G becomes negative in following situation. If delta S is positive, on increasing temperature T, the value T delta S increases, so delta H is less than T delta S. In this situation, delta G will become negative. If coupling of two reactions, that is reduction and oxidation, results in negative value of delta G for overall reaction, the finally reaction becomes feasible. Such coupling is easily understood through Gibbs energy versus T plot for the formation of oxides. These plots are drawn for free energy changes that occur from 1 gram mole of oxygen is consumed. The graphical representation of Gibbs energy was first used by H.J.T. Ellingham. This provides a sound basis for considering the choice of reducing agent in the reduction of oxides. This is known as Ellingham diagram. Such diagrams helps us in predicting the feasibility of the reduction of an ore. As we know, during reduction, the oxide of metal decomposes and the reducing agent takes away the oxygen. The role of reducing agent is to provide delta G negative and large enough to make the sum of delta G of the two reactants, that is oxidation of reducing agent and reduction of metal oxide, negative. If reduction is carried out by carbon, the oxidation of reducing agent will be there. C plus half O2 gives CO. There may also be complete oxidation of carbon to CO2. On coupling, big reaction 6.15 and 6.16, we get MXO plus CS gives XM plus CO. On coupling reaction, we have MXO plus half C gives XM plus half CO2. Similarly, if carbon monoxide is reducing agent, reactions are given below need to be coupled. CO gave plus half O2 gives CO2. Overall reaction will be as follows. Ellingham diagram normally consists of plots of delta G versus T for the formation of oxides of common metals and reducing agents. In this reaction, gas is consumed in the formation of oxide. Hence, molecular randomness decreases in the formation of oxide, which leads to a negative value of delta S. As a result, sine of T delta S term in equation becomes positive, subsequently shift towards higher side despite rising T. The result is positive slope in the curve for most of the reactions for the formation of MXO. Each plot is a straight line and slopes upward and some changes in phase takes place. The temperature at which the changes occurs is indicated by an increase in the slope on positive side. When temperature is raised, a point is reached in the curve where it crosses delta G is equal to 0 line. Below this temperature, delta G for the formation of oxide is negative, so MXO is stable. Above this, free energy of formation of oxide is positive, therefore the oxide will decompose on its own. Similar diagrams are constructed for sulfides and halides. From them, it becomes clear that why reduction of MX is difficult. The graph simply indicates whether a reaction is possible or not. Limitations of Ellingham diagram. The tendency of reduction with a reducing agent is indicated. This is so because it is based only on the thermodynamic concepts. It does not explain the kinetics of the reduction process. It cannot answer questions like how fast reduction can proceed. However, it explains the reaction are sluggish when every species is in solid state and smooth when the ore melts down. The interpretation of delta G is based on K. Delta G is equal to minus RT ln K. This is presumed that the reactants and the products are in equilibrium. MXO plus A gives XM plus AO. This is not always true because of the reactant product may be solid in commercial processes. Reactants and products are in contact for a short time.
A reaction describes the actual reduction of metal oxide that we want to accomplish. The delta G values for these reactions in general can be obtained from the corresponding delta G values of oxides. As we have seen, heating favors a negative value of delta G. Therefore, the temperature is chosen such that the sum of delta G in the two combined redox reaction is negative. In delta G versus T plots, Hillingham diagram, this is indicated by the point of intersection of two curves, that is, the curve of the formation of MXO and that for the formation of the oxide of the reducing substance. After that point, the delta G values becomes more negative for the combined process, making the reduction possible. The difference in the two delta G values after that point determines whether reduction of oxide of the element of the upper line is feasible by the element of which oxide formation is represented by the lower line. If the difference is large, the reduction is easier. Applications: extraction of iron from its oxides. After concentration mixture of oxides of iron is subjected to calcination or roasting to remove water, to decompose carbonates and to oxide sulfides. After that, these are mixed with limestone and coke and fed into a blast furnace from its top, in which the oxide is reduced to the metal in the blast furnace. Reduction of iron takes place at different temperature ranges. A blast of hot air is blown from the bottom of the furnace by burning coke in the lower portion to give temperature up to about 2200 Kelvin. The burning of coke therefore supplies most of the heat required in the process. The CO and heat move to the upper part of the furnace. In upper part, the temperature is lower and the iron oxides Fe2O3 and Fe3O4 coming from the top are reduced in steps to FeO. These reactions can be summarized as follows. At 500 to 800 Kelvin, Fe2O3 is reduced to Fe3O4 and then to FeO. 3Fe2O3 plus CO gives 2Fe3O4 plus CO2. Fe3O4 plus 4CO gives 3Fe plus 4CO2. Fe2O3 plus CO gives 2FeO plus CO2. Limestone is also decomposed to CaO, which removes silicate impurity of the ore as slag. The slag is molten state and separates out from the iron. At 900 to 1500 Kelvin, C plus CO2 gives 2CO, FeO plus CO gives Fe plus CO2. Thermodynamics help to understand us how coke reduces the oxide and why this furnace is chosen. One of the main reduction steps in the process involves reaction below. FeO plus C gives Fe plus CO. This reaction can be seen as a reaction in which two simpler reactions have coupled. In one, the reduction of FeO is taking place, and in the other, C is being oxidized to CO. FeO plus gives Fe plus a half O2, C plus half O2 gives CO. When both the reaction takes place to yield the equation, the net gives energy change becomes delta G plus delta G reaction equals to delta RG. Naturally, the resultant reaction will take place. when the right hand side equation is negative in delta Rg versus T plot, change Fe to FeO goes upward, that representing that change C to CO goes downward. They cross each other at 1073 Kelvin. At temperatures above 7073 Kelvin, the CCO line is below the FeO line. So above 1073 Kelvin, in the range of temperature 900 to 1500 K, coke will reduce FeO and will itself be oxidized to CO. Let's just try to understand this through figure 6.6. At about 1673 Kelvin, value for the reaction to FeO gives to Fe plus O2 is plus 341 kilojoule mole inverse, because it is reverse of Fe gives FeO. Change and for the reaction to C plus O2 gives to CO plus delta Rg is minus 447 kilojoule mole inverse. If we calculate delta G for overall reaction, therefore reaction becomes feasible. In a similar way, the reduction of Fe3O4 and Fe2O3 by CO at relatively lower temperatures can be explained on the basis of lower lying points of intersection of their curves with CO-CO2 curve. The iron obtained from blast furnace contains about 4% carbon and many impurities in smaller amount. This is known as pig iron. It can be molded into a variety of shapes. Cast iron is different from pig iron and is made by melting pig iron with scrap iron and coke using hot air blast. It has slightly lower carbon content, about 3%, and extremely hard and brittle. Further reacting, wrought iron or malleable iron is the purest form of commercial iron and is prepared from cast iron by oxidizing impurities in a reverberatory furnace lined with hematite. The hematite oxidizes carbon to carbon monoxide. Fe2O3 plus 3C gives to Fe plus 3CO. Limestone is added as a flux and sulfur. Silicon and phosphorus are oxidized and passed into slag. The metal is removed and freed from slag by passing through rollers. Extraction of copper from cuprous oxide. In the graph delta R versus T, for the formation of oxides, the copper to O line is almost at the top, so it is quite easy to reduce oxide dose of copper directly to the metal by heating with coke. The line CCO and CCO2 are at much lower positions in the graph, particularly after 500 to 600 Kelvin. However, many of the ores are sulfides and may also contain iron. The sulfide ores are roasted, smelted to give oxides. The oxide can be easily reduced to metallic copper using coke. In actual process, the ore is heated in a reverberatory furnace after mixing with silica. In the furnace, iron oxide slags off as iron silicate is formed. Copper is produced in the form of copper matte. This contains copper 2S and FeS. FeO plus SiO2 gives FeSiO3. Copper matte is then charged into silica lined converter. Some silica is also added and hot air blast is blown to convert the remaining FeS, FeO and copper sulfide and copper oxide to the metallic copper. Following reaction takes place, 2FeS plus 3O2 gives 2FeO plus SO2. FeO plus SiO2 gives SiO3. 2CO2S plus 3O2 gives 2CO2O plus 2SO2. 2CO2O plus 2CO2S gives 6Cu plus SO2. The solidified copper obtained has blistered appearance due to evolution of SO2, and so it is called blister copper. Extraction of zinc from zinc oxide. The reduction of zinc oxide is done using coke. The temperature in this case is higher than that in case of copper. For the purpose of heating, the oxide is made into briquettes with coke and clay. The metal is distilled off and collected by rapid chilling. Electrochemical principles of metallurgy. We have seen how principles of thermodynamics are applied to pyrometallurgy. Similar principles are effective in the reduction of metal ions in solutions or molten state. Here they are reduced by electrolysis or by adding some reducing element. In the reduction of a molten metal salt, electrolysis is done. Such methods are based on electrochemical principles which could be understood through the equation. Here N is the number of electrons and E is the electrode potential. Delta G is equals to minus N E F. The E is the electrode potential of the redox couple formed in the system. More reactive metals have large negative values of the electrode potential, so their reduction is difficult. If the difference of two E values corresponds to a positive E and consequently negative delta G in the equation, then the less reactive metal will come out of the solution and the more reactive metal will go into the solution. In simple electrolysis, the Mn positive ions are discharged at negative electrodes and deposited there. Precautions are taken considering the reactivity of the metal produced and the suitable materials are used as electrodes. Sometimes a flux is added for making the molten mass more conducting. Aluminium. In the metallurgy of aluminium, purified Al2O3 is mixed with Na3AlF6 or CaF2, which lowers the melting point of the mixture and brings conductivity. The fuse matrix is electrolyzed. Steel vessel with lining of carbon acts as cathode and graphite anode is used. The overall reaction may be written as 2Al2O3 plus 3C gives 4Al plus 3CO2. This process of electrolysis is widely known as Hall-Heroldt process. Thus, electrolysis of molten mass is carried out in an electrolytic cell using carbon electrodes. The oxygen liberated at the anode reacts with the carbon of anode producing CO and CO2. This way, for each kg of aluminium produced, about 0.5 kg of carbon anode is burned away. The electrolytic reactions are aluminium 3 positive plus 3 electron gives aluminium, C plus O2 negative gives CO plus 2 electron, C plus 2 O2 negative gives CO2 plus 4 electron, copper from low grade ores and scraps. Copper is extracted by hydrometallurgy from low grade ores. It is leached out using acid or bacteria. The solution containing copper 2 positive is treated with scrap iron or hydrogen. Copper 2 positive plus hydrogen gives copper plus 2H positive. Oxidation reduction. Besides reduction, some extractions are based on oxidation, particularly for nonmetals. A very common example of extraction based on oxidation is the extraction of chlorine from brine solution. 2 chlorine plus 2H2O gives 2OH negative plus H2 plus Cl2. Delta G for reaction is plus 422. Then it is converted to E using delta G is equals to minus NEF. We get E is equals to minus 2.2 volt. Naturally, it will require an external EMF that is greater than 2.2 volt, but the electrolysis requires an excess potential to overcome some other hindering reactions. Thus, Cl2 obtained by electrolysis giving out hydrogen and aqueous NOH as byproducts. Electrolysis of molten NaCl is also carried out, but in that case, Na metal is produced and not NaOH. As studied earlier, extraction of gold and silver involves leaching the metal with Cn negative. This is also oxidation reaction. The metal is later recovered by displacement method. In this reaction, zinc acts as an reducing agent. Refining. A metal extracted by any method is usually contaminated with some impurity. For obtaining metals of high purity, several techniques are used. Depending upon the differences in properties of metal and the impurity, some are listed below. Distillation. Distillation, this is very useful for low boiling metals like zinc and mercury. This impure metal is evaporated to obtain the pure metal as distillate. Liquation. In this method,
A low melting metal like tin can be made to flow on a sloping surface. In this way, it is separated from higher melting impurities. Electrolytic refining. In this method, the impure metal is made to act as anode. A strip of the same metal is pure form is used as cathode. They are put in a suitable electrolytic bath containing soluble salt of the same metal. The more basic metal remains in the solution and the less basic ones go to the anode mart. This process is also explained using the concept of electrode potential. Over potential and gives energy, which you have seen in previous sections. The reactions are anode, M gives Mn positive plus N electron. Cathode, Mn positive plus N electron gives M. Copper is refined using an electrolytic method. Anodes are of impure copper and pure copper strips are taken as cathode. The electrolyte is acidified solution of copper sulfate and the net result of electrolysis is the transfer of copper in pure form from the anode to the cathode. Impurities from blister copper deposit as anode mud, which contains antimony, selenium, tellurium, silver, gold and platinum. Recovery of these elements may meet the cost of refining. Zinc may be also refined this way. Zone refining. This method is based on the principle that the impurities are soluble in the melt than in the solid state of the metal. A mobile heater surrounding the rods of impure metal is fixed at its one end. The molten zone moves along with the heater, which is moved forward. As the heater moves forward, the pure metal crystallizes out of metal left behind and the impurities pass on to the adjacent new molten zone created by movement of heaters. The process is repeated several times and the heater is removed in the same direction again and again. Impurities get concentrated at one end. This end is cut off. This method is very useful for producing semiconductor and other metals of very high purity. Example, germanium, silicon, boron, gallium and indium. Wafer phase refining. In this method, the metal is converted into its volatile compound, which is collected and decomposed to give pure metal. So the two requirements are: metal should be a form of volatile compound with an available reagent. The volatile compound should be easily decomposable so that recovery is easy. Following example will illustrate. Mond process for refining nickel. In this process, nickel is heated in a stream of carbon monoxide forming a volatile complex named as nickel tetracarbonyl. This complex is decomposed at higher temperature to obtain pure metal. When Arkel method for refining zirconium or titanium. The method is very useful for removing all the oxygen and nitrogen present in the form of impurity in certain metals like zirconium or titanium. The crude metal is heated in an evacuated vessel with iodine. The metal iodide form being more covalent volatilizes. Zirconium plus 2I2 gives ZrI4. The metal iodide is decomposed on a tungsten filament, electrically heated to about 1800 Kelvin. The pure metal deposits on the filament. Chromatographic methods. You have learned about chromatographic techniques of purification of substances in class 11th. Chromatography is very useful for purification of elements which are available in minute quantities and impurities are not very different in chemical properties from the element to be purified. Uses of aluminium, copper and zinc and iron. Aluminium foils are used as wrapper for food materials. The fine dust of metal is used in paints and lacquers. Aluminium being highly reactive is also used in extraction of chromium and manganese from their oxides. Wires of aluminium are used as electricity conductors. Alloys containing aluminium being light are very useful. Copper is used for making wires used in electrical industry and for water and steam pipes. It is used in several alloys that are rather tougher than the metal itself, for example, brass, bronze, and coinage alloy. Zinc is used for galvanizing iron. It is used in large quantities in batteries. It is constituent of many alloys, example, brass and German silver. Zinc dust is used as a reducing agent in the manufacture of dyestuffs. Cast iron, which is most important type of iron, used for casting gloves, railway sleepers, gutter pipes, toys, etc. It is used in the manufacture of wrought iron and steel. Wrought iron is used in anchoring anchors, wires, bolts, chains, and agricultural implements. Steel finds a number of uses. Alloy steel is obtained when other metals are added to it. Nickel steel is used for making cables, automobiles and aeroplane parts. Pendulum measuring tapes. Chrome steel is used for cutting tools and crushing machines. And stainless steel is used for cycles, automobiles, utensils, pens, etc. Summary. Although modern metallurgy had exponential growth after industrial revolution, many modern concepts in metallurgy have their roots in ancient practices predated the industrial revolution. For over 7,000 years, India has had the high tradition of metallurgical skills. Ancient Indian metallurgists have made major contributions which deserve their place in metallurgical history of the world. In case of zinc and high carbon steel, ancient India contributed significantly for the development of the base for the modern metallurgical advancement, which induced metallurgical study leading to industrial revolution. Metals are required for a variety of purposes. For this, we need their extraction from the minerals in which they are present and from which their extraction is commercially feasible. These minerals are known as ores. Ores of the metal are associated with many impurities. Removal of these impurities to a certain extent is achieved in concentration steps. The concentrated ore is then treated chemically for obtaining the metal. Usually the metal compounds reduced to the metal. The reducing agent used for carbon, carbon oxide, or even some metals. In the reaction processes, the thermodynamic and electrochemical concepts are given due concentration. The metal oxide reacts with reducing agent. The oxide is reduced to the metal and reducing agent is oxidized. In the two reactions, the net gives energy change is negative, which becomes more negative on raising the temperature. Conversion of physical states from solid to liquid or to gas and formation of gaseous state favors decrease in the Gibbs energy for entire system. This concept is graphically displayed in plots of delta G versus T for such oxidation reduction reactions at different temperatures. The concept of electrode potential is useful in isolation of metals, where the sum of two redox couples is positive so that the Gibbs energy change is negative. The metals obtained by usual methods still contain minor impurities. Getting pure metals require refining. Refining process depends on differences in properties of metal and impurities. Extraction of aluminium is usually carried out from its oxide ore by leaching it with NaOH. Sodium aluminate thus formed is separated and then neutralized to give back the hydrated oxide, which is then electrolyzed using cryolite as a flux. Extraction of ore iron is done by reduction of oxide ore in blast furnace. Copper is extracted by smelting and heating in a reverberatory furnace. Extraction of zinc from zinc oxides is done using coke. Several methods are employed in refining the metals in different metals in general are widely used and have contributed significantly in the development of variety of industries. Summary of occurrence of some metals. Aluminium is present in the form of bauxite ore and cryolite, iron in hematite and magnetite, copper in copper pyrites, copper glands, maleachite and cuprite, and zinc in zinc blend, calamine and zincite.